everybody. Dave Brown here at ringside with all these folks, and we're ready to go with another day of USWA Championship Wrestling. By the way, Michael St. John, a bit under the weather today. He will be back with us next week. Today, we've already seen more of him than I want to see, but Leatherface is scheduled right here in the ring in a single match coming up today. A bit later on, the flamboyant one, Eric Embry, also scheduled to go. Jeff Jarrett and Robert Fuller, one of the favorite tag teams anywhere in wrestling, will be here. And also, what a main event we got coming up, featuring on one side of the ring, the team of the superstar, Bill Dundee and Danny Davis. All of that coming up today. Stay with us. We'll be back with the opening match right after this. Leatherface into the area here. T.D. Steele already in the ring. We're set to go with the opening match. Referee Paul Neighbor said ring the bell. Leatherface jumped T.D. Steele. Boy, he never even had a chance. Leatherface, big, long, tall, lanky guy, jumps T.D. T.D.'s got some fans here, but boy. Leatherface choking him, not even giving him a chance. He jumped in the ring. Came running in the door with that chainsaw. Thank goodness it didn't have it cranked up here today. Dojo Yamamoto's at ringside encouraging Leatherface. Edie Steele up in the air. Leatherface drops him on the top rope. He bounces down to the mat. Leatherface is there. Shoulders are down. Counts of three. This match is over. And Leatherface comes out of the ring, picks up the chainsaw. Oh, what is this? He knocks Tojo down. Tojo is going to congratulate him and help him out of here. All right. Eric Embry and Tom Prichard in. Get the chainsaw. Tojo's got the chainsaw. Thank goodness he's got it out of here. Now, Embry and Prichard have Leatherface in tow, trying to get him out of here. Let's go to a break. We'll be back in a moment. Off to an interesting start, to say the least, here today on USWA Wrestling. Here comes the King right here. I want to get him around here and talk to him about maybe about the action which just went on here and about action coming up. By the way, more about this later. We begin a new time next week. We'll be on beginning at 10 o'clock. And again, we'll have more to say about that later. King, you saw what went on with that goofy Leatherface out here.
Yeah, well, I saw what went on today, but what more importantly is what went on last week in that World Heavyweight Championship match. Now, I want to come out here right now and say that it goes without saying that I'm not just a little bit pleased with what took place last week. Now, first, I listened to Reggie B. Fine run his mouth about how big and how bad this Awesome Kong was and how much they deserve the World Heavyweight title shot. Well, he got the shot, and Reggie B. Fine put up all the gold, and I had a chance to walk out of there with it all. Now, it's true. Awesome Kong is an awesome individual. I mean, he weighs 465 pounds, and there's not a whole lot you can do with a guy like this. What you have to do is exactly what I said I was going to do, and that's try to outsmart him. Now, I thought that I had the match pretty well in hand when I had finally got Awesome Kong laying flat on his back, and I jumped off that second rope with his big fist drop about four straight times and had him finished. And then I was expecting Reggie B. Fine to come in and try to save his man, which he did. And I did a little number on Reggie B. Fine, which, you know, his lips may be a little bit bigger than they were last week today because I busted him right in the mouth. Now, let me say this. That was all I was expecting. When I had Reggie B. Fine handled and when I had Awesome Kong laying flat on his back, I expected that match to be over and all of that gold to be in my hand. But no, what happens? This jerk Leatherface and Tojo come from out of the back with that big chain, and the next thing I know, I'm being thrown in and clotheslined with that chain between Kong and Leatherface. And then what happens is I look up and Reggie B. Fine and Awesome Kong are walking out of the ring with my World Heavyweight Championship belt. Well, Leatherface, we're going to take things as they come. We're going to do them one by one in order here. Sure, I want to get that belt back around my waist. I want to be the World Heavyweight Champion again. But we're going to take the first order of business first. And to me, that is you, Leatherface. I want to find out just exactly who it is that Eric Embry has brought up here from Texas and put entrusted to Tojo Yamamoto. I want to find out who it is that wants to come out here with a running chainsaw, cut up this desk, try to terrorize the crowd, and try to do a number on me. I want to find out what kind of jerk this takes. So what we're going to do is we're going to have us a little match this Monday night. And we're going to have a couple of things at stake. It seems like now you can't just get a match for the sake of having a wrestling match. It seems you like you got to always put something at stake. So Tojo Yamamoto has demanded the only way that he's going to put his man in there is if I put something at stake that I have said in the past I never want to do again, because it puts you under a lot of pressure. And that's talking about the same thing that happened to Eddie Marlin and the same thing that happened to Paul Neighbors and the same thing that could happen to Eric Embry or Cousin Harold this week. I'm talking about putting my hair at stake. That's the only way that Tojo would go for this match. So Leatherface, when you come in that ring, you can have all your guys watching in the back. You can have Tojo at ringside, and you can know in that mind of yours, if you got one, that if you beat me, if you pin the King of Wrestling, and there's no time limit and no disqualification, somebody's going to get pinned. And if you pin me, then I'm going to have to sit down in that chair, and they're going to shave my head bald just like they did Eddie Marlins and just like they did Paul Neighbors. But the other thing is, Leatherface, is if I beat you, no, not if, when I beat you, when I pin your shoulders, I don't care if you got Awesome Kong, Reggie B. Fine, Tojo, Eric Embry, whoever you want to run out to the ring and try to help you. I don't care about that. All I'm interested in is you, punk, and I'm going to pin your shoulders. And when I do, we're going to take that mask off because it's in the contract. That mask is coming off that face, and we're going to see exactly who this jerk is. So if you've been wondering, as I have, if you've been, it's been on your mind, who exactly is Leatherface, I promise you this, and I don't make many promises unless I intend to keep them. We're going to find out Monday night just exactly who is under the mask, Leatherface. So pack a lunch, because it may take a while, boy, because when you get the king on you, like I'm going to be on you Monday night, you're not going to like it. I can promise you that. And we're going to find out exactly who that is Monday night.
The king, the hair is on the line against the mask of Leatherface. Boy, I tell you what, I got to tell you, I'd be more worried about that match today than I would have been maybe 5 or 6 weeks ago. Because Eddie Marlin, as the king just mentioned, lost his hair in a match, as did referee Paul Neighbors. And the thing about it is, Jerry's never lost his hair in a match, but neither had Eddie Marlin up to that point. Well, let's take a look at the complete card. It's going to be a great night. It's Homecoming 91. It's back to the Mid-South Coliseum. Mid-South Coliseum, Monday night. Box office will be open at 10 o'clock, so you can pick up your tickets in advance for the action, which begins at 8 o'clock Monday night. And again, we are back at the Mid-South Coliseum. Opening match of the night, Brian Christopher will be going against Heartbreaker Randy Harris. Should be a good opening match, couple of fine young wrestlers going here. Then, World Light Heavyweight title match, the superstar, Bill Dundee, against Nightmare Danny Davis. Now, these two are going to be here in a tag team a little bit later on today, but when there's a world title at stake, well, it can result in some strange pairing sometime. And that's going to be the case when the superstar will be going against Nightmare Danny Davis, the World Light Heavyweight title on the line. Following that, with the heavyweight title will be on the line. Maybe not. I see there's a substitution here, and that maybe Kong will not be putting that belt up, but Kong will be going against Samson. You will meet Samson a little bit later on today. We'll talk about this one more later. Loser leave town match coming up. No time limit, no disqualification. The team of the Brawlers split up after last week, and Robert Fuller this week will be going against Brawler number 2 in a single match. Loser leaves town. You see it, no time limit, no disqualification. And then in the next match, Jeff Jarrett will be going against Brawler number 1. Same stipulations. Loser leaves town, no time limit, no disqualification. Following that, it's a back alley street brawl. It continues until one team loses their clothes. Dirty white boy, dirty white girl on one side of the ring, on the other, Dr. Tom Prichard and Miss Texas. Look out for this one. The back alley street brawl rules. Then the main event of the night. Actually, it's the first of two big main events. Hair versus the mask. Must be a winner. No time limit, no disqualification. You heard the king talking about it. He had to put his hair on the line against Leatherface's mask. The king promises to unmask Leatherface Monday night at the Coliseum. Tojo, who will be in Leatherface's corner, is going to be looking to cut the hair of Jerry Lawler. As I said, it's never been done. The king has never lost his hair in a match, and really does not like to put the hair up in a match like this, but we'll do it Monday night at the Coliseum. Then, following that, the second main event of the night, and in this one, hair versus hair, too, must be a winner in the match. Cousin Harold will be going against Eric Embry, the flamboyant one who also will have Tojo Yamamoto in his corner. Some kind of card coming up Monday night. Homecoming 91, back to the Mid-South Coliseum. I'm going to be at the Coliseum to see this one. 8 o'clock is when it all begins. Monday night, make your plans to be there. Remember, you can pick up your tickets in advance beginning at 10 o'clock Monday morning when the box office opens. We will be back here with more action in just a moment. Frazier in the ring right now. Referee Paul Neighbors is there. Here comes Tojo Yamamoto waving the Texas flag. And there is the flamboyant one, Eric Embry. Embry doesn't look too happy here today as he comes to ringside. I don't know what he said. He shouted some sort of insult at Chris Frazier. Hands the robe to Tojo Yamamoto. The crowd chanting, Erica, Erica. Nickname put on Eric Embry by the king. Referee Paul Neighbors calls for the bell, and here we go. One fall, 10-minute time limit match. Eric Embry, now with an insult to the crowd. He's pretty much disregarding Chris Frazier. He's watching him out of the corner of his eye, I'm sure, but I'd better pay attention. Embry slams Frazier's head into the top turnbuckle. Wow, he nailed him with a right fist. He smacked him right on the side of the jaw. Referee, I can't hear what Embry is yelling. Embry is yelling something at Chris Frazier. Boom, got him with a right hand again. He's used that right fist twice already, and Chris Frazier. What's he saying? Where's Fatso? I think he's probably talking about Cousin Harold. Well, this is not Cousin Harold, Eric Embry. This is Chris Frazier. Boy, he knocked him down again. Frazier, unable to get anything going here today. At a disadvantage when the pairing was announced. But he certainly has not been able to get anything going against Eric Embry. Embry now turns to the referee and says, hey, get out of my face. Leave me alone. I'll take care of this. As usual, Embry freely violating the rules. That was a forearm. That's the first. He's been hitting him with a fist up until now. Embry, big broad arm across the back. And there's a fist. He staggers Frazier again. So far, Chris Frazier in serious trouble all the way, but Embry has not gone for a pin. Well, Embry just wants to hurt him. Embry finally has the cover. Count of two and three. I think he could have probably ended it some time ago. But he didn't elect to do it. Finally, though, he gets the count of three, and Eric Embry has a victory. You know, he didn't have much trouble with Chris Frazier here today, but I think there's somebody who's come along that he maybe can't handle like that. Take a look at this videotape, and you'll understand. We're going to watch a tape right now.
Team into the corner. Anthony in a bad place now as Miss Texas climbs up. The white girl going up behind her, pulls her down. Off of the white girl, starts flying away on her. You look out, dirty white girl. Eric Embry has her, throws her up into the ring. Anthony throws Miss Texas in. White girl, look out, it's Embry. Just leveled the dirty white girl. Fired off on each other now. Tony Anthony outside the ring now. With Prichard, with Cousin Harold. Says, wait a minute. As Embry had a pair of scissors that he got from Tojo. There goes Embry over the top rope. Embry just yanked the chair out from under me I was sitting in. Oh! Just nailed Cousin Harold. Cousin Harold took it right over the top of the head. Embry has no effect with the metal chair.
He will not leave Eric Embry here at Tojo waving that.
Hey, it's real simple. Don't you ever take a commercial and leave me out here again. That's real, real simple. Jerry Lawler, you're out here running your mouth about the line of sight. You ain't got to do nothing, Lawler. Now, Eddie Bart. Eddie Murray. Hey, come here, Dave Brown.
You're...
I'm going to ask you a couple questions. Just shut up and listen. Let me ask you something. Ever since I'm going to tell you something. Ever since I've been here, man, I have outsmarted, I've outwhooped everybody I've come up against, especially the matchmaker anymore. I've outthought you. I've outsmarted you. But Eddie Marlin, I'm man enough to come out here and say, man, that you copped one on me. You copped one on me. Real simple, Dave Brown. That big, fat Cousin Harold against me. The loser gets their head shaved. Well, Eddie Marlin, I don't have to say what you're trying to do, man, because I know what you're trying to do. And you know what I did? You know what I did? I said, I ain't gonna have the match, man. And I picked up the telephone. I packed my bags, and I called the USWA office in Dallas, Texas. And I said, I'm coming home. Eddie Marlin can shove the USWA where the sun don't shine in Tennessee. And you know what they told me? They told me if I walked out of here, I couldn't wrestle in Texas no more either. Well, it's real simple. Yeah, show your intelligence, you stupid Tennessean. It's real simple. I'm going to have the match, Eddie Marlin. Yeah, I'm going to have the match against that big fat goose. His hair gets my hair. Monday night at the Coliseum. They moved it in the Coliseum, Dad, because they said the other building wasn't big enough. Because all you egg-sucking Tennesseans are gonna come to see me get my hair cut. What a dick is stacked against me. You see me hit him with the chairs? He just shook his head and looked at me. And I hit him as hard as I could hit him. And he just went, ah! Well, it's real simple, Dave Brown. You know what happens when you put your hand on a stove? You know what happens? It burns you, don't it?
Yeah.
Why, if Cousin Al put his hand on a stove, it just sizzle right through, man. Because the nerve endings that go up to the brain, that say pain. Well, there ain't nothing up there to register with. I know when I hit him with the chair, there wasn't nothing up there to bang against his skull to say it hurt. So, real simple, Eddie Marlin. You pull the fast one, and I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know how I'm going to get in that match. I don't even know how I'm going to come out with my hands in there. But I swear as long as there's a breath left in this body anymore, then you look at those eyes. If I lose one hair of this flamboyant piece of hair, Eddie Marlin, you'll pay a price that no man has ever paid before in the history of professional wrestling. And if you don't believe I'm serious, you look at my eyes, Eddie Marlin, and it's not a threat. It ain't a threat, Dave Brown. It's a promise, Eddie Marlin. It's a promise.
Eric Embry, the flamboyant one. Well, he's upset. Claims the deck has been stacked against him. Going to be hair against hair. Must be a winner for that match coming up. I want to tell you about the action coming up around the territory, but I want to get him out of here first, if you don't mind. He's headed for the exits now. Let's just hope he keeps going. Let's take a look at the action coming up around the territory in the USWA. Holly Springs, Mississippi, coming up on the 16th. It'll be at Rust College. Eric Embry, oh, my goodness, good luck, Holly Springs. Embry's going to be in town. Dr. Tom Prichard will be there. Jeff Jarrett, Robert Fuller, Superstar, Bill Dundee, Miss Texas, all of them in Holly Springs on Friday, August 16th. Buy your tickets in advance, and you save $1. They are on sale at the college. Also coming up in Grenada, Mississippi, on Friday the 23rd at the City Auditorium, the King will be there. Awesome Kong, Dundee, Leatherface. Again, buy your tickets in advance and save $1. Coming up Friday night, August 23rd, also in Bolivar, Tennessee, at Central High School. Tickets are available at all the local banks right now, sponsored by the JCs of Hardeman County. Bolivar Central High School on Friday the 23rd. Saturday the 24th. USWA Wrestling will be back in Jonesboro, Arkansas. And as you can see, tickets are now on sale for that. More about that in coming weeks. Friday, August 30th in Forest City, Arkansas. Buy your tickets in advance and you'll save $1 here. That's going to be at the Civic Center. And coming soon, there will be wrestling action in Kennett, Missouri. That's all the action coming up around the territory. We got some more of it coming up right here when we return. said we got a team coming out here. Well, we have a former team coming out here, because after last week, can't wrestle as a tag team anymore. Talking about the Barroom Brawler.
That's too true, Dave Brown. You would think we probably would be pretty upset, you know, but we lost to a great team. I give them credit. Robert Fuller and Jeff Jarrett are a great team. They used some questionable tactics to beat us, but hey, we're not crying over spilled milk. So you think we'd be pretty disappointed today?
Yeah, I would expect you to
Well, you're wrong. Because we did just... You're wrong. We did just exactly what we wanted to do. Them boys have been taking a beating for about 4 weeks, and we're still here standing tall. We love a good beating. What's happened right now, we've got these boys in a lose-or-leave-town match. You know who brawler number one is? You know who number two is? Nobody knows. Them boys don't know who they're wrestling. We've been studying them out, and you know what?
One from two. They don't know how to count that far.
We visited the USWA offices, and you know what we found out?
Tell them what we found out, baby.
You want to tell them? You want me to tell them?
No, you tell them. You tell them. Go ahead.
Them boys ain't worth a hoot in single matches. They can't beat anybody's grandma in single matches. So we're going to take them and tear them apart, and then they're going to have to go to U-Haul. And they're going to be, I'll be waving bye to them when they leave.
Baby.
They can take those belts. They can be champions, Oklahoma, Wyoming, New York, anywhere. But they're not going to be around the USWA anymore. Bye, boys. Tell them, brother.
Let me tell you what. Fuller and Jarrett, you're a good team, baby. You beat a great team right here in the Brawlers. But let me tell you what. They had to have help, Dave Brown. Let me tell you what. You know what? Single matches. No disqualification, loser leave town. So you know what that means, baby? You know what that means, baby?
What does that mean?
That means that the souped-up hippie and the Kmart cowboy, Robert Fuller and Jeff Jarrett,
K-Mart.
Are going to get in their 1973 beat-up rotten station wagon and drive down the road, because they're gone, baby. And let me tell you what else.
Kmart.
You might not see us as a tag team anymore, baby, but you're never going to see Jeff Jarrett and Robert Fuller in the USWA anymore, baby.
We're not going anywhere. We're not going anywhere. We're here to stay.
Well, they said a couple of things that make some sense. And one is that everybody now thinks of Jeff and Robert as a tag team. I'm not sure how closely they check the record books on single matches, though, but they feel that they've got Jeff and Robert right where they want them in single matches because they think they got a better chance than they do in the tag team. Remains to be seen this week. Take a look, though, at Jeff Jarrett and Robert Fuller. I think they can handle themselves.
Muriel
Jeff Jarrett and Robert Fuller headed this way. I'd like to talk to them just before they go up to the ring. They're scheduled today in a tag team match here on USWA Action. Sabu is headed into the ring right now. All right, somebody keep an eye on him. Maybe we get Robert Jeff over here. Robert, welcome in.
Walking in Memphis was fun, I got to tell you. You know,
walking with those belts again.
We might be walking our last time in Memphis. We don't get ourselves together this upcoming week.
Well, we are. You know, I sat down and listened to the barroom brawlers, and they told lie after lie after lie, but they had one thing right, and Dave, you hit on it just a little second ago. Yeah, you said one thing right. Me and Robert Fuller are a great team. We've gone through the brawlers, the hangmen, every team that's been put in front of us. But you guys, yeah, you're out here saying that you don't think we can hold our own in single matches? Well, let me just tell you a little bit about the stud's background. When he first started wrestling, that's what he was. He was a single wrestler, and that's how he made his name. No, he wasn't with a pack of horses. He was by himself. He made himself the name Tennessee Stud.
Leader of the pack.
The leader of the pack, yeah. He's had the stud stable, and he's always led guys. The meanest bunch of guys that ever assembled in wrestling. So, boys, you better get ready, because the stud's going to bring everything he's got, and he's going to run you clean out of town.
You know, and I want to say a few things, you know, about Jeff. For the people that hadn't followed his background, I have, that I've gone out and checked when I decided that I would take this loser leave town. I went out and checked a little bit on Jeff's background. You know, when Jeff first started, he didn't win his first match. And he probably didn't win his first 15 matches because, you know, it's hard to get a start in this profession as any other. But one thing Jeff did do, 1986, that was his first year in professional wrestling, he won the honors of Rookie of the Year. And I happen to know that there's more guys starting in this business year by year by year. That is one of the hardest titles that you can ever win, Rookie of the Year. 6 months later, Jeff went on to the Cotton Bowl, one of the biggest programs ever put together in professional wrestling, and beat the great Texas star Eric Embry himself right there for the Texas Heavyweight Championship, and then went on to win the Southern title, and then went on to win what I feel is the most prestigious title in the world today, the World Tag Team Championships for the USWA. We are rated number one, number two in your wrestling magazines throughout the whole country as a tag team. As singles, I can tell you this, I came to put this man one time about 2 years ago out of professional wrestling, and I never set my mind to do anything I didn't get done. That I did not get done, thank goodness, because the guy wound up to be the greatest friend I ever had, let alone the greatest partner that I ever had. I can say this, if they think that they're going to put Jeff or myself, one of us or either the two of us, out of professional wrestling where the USWA is concerned, they're going to have another thing coming, because we're the world's champions. We're not dumping these belts because we lose to a couple of slobs like you guys. I can tell you this, boys, where I'm concerned, and I know Jeff backs me up, you want to come out there and grab your chairs on the way out, load yourself down with artillery, buckle it up real tight, son, because this man right here ain't going down for nobody, let alone the likes of you two bums. And there's one thing we love about it. When this thing is all over and the dust clears, the two ugliest, good-for-nothing, grimiest bums that's ever come into the USWA are going to be gone. And that's it.
All right, Robert and Jeff, I don't know much more we can add to it as they head for the ring right now. Sammu, I guess, doesn't have a partner, huh?
What's that?
Sammu apparently doesn't have a partner here.
Well, that's true. You know, we had hoped to have a tag team match today, but, you know, there ain't a lot of guys right now wanting to climb through those ropes in that squared circle with the likes of me and Jeff. We got a pretty good reputation going behind us, and it's not in single matches. Right now it's in tag matches, but, you know, let's clear it all up. We're happy to do the singles.
I tell you what, excuse me for interrupting. This gives us a good opportunity. Ernie, if we could have that other chair, let's if you would stay with us and comment on this, and this will give us a chance to take a look at Jeff in a single match right here. Yeah, we'll get you a chair. That microphone is live, and let's just talk about this situation. Have a seat, Robert.
Well, Jeff, right now, is not like he has Apache in here wrestling in this match. This man, Sabu, right here, just a few weeks ago, one of the top contenders for our tag team belts, along with Judge Dredd. He's a pretty tough guy, and he's a little crafty. Jeff's going to have his hands full here. I got all the confidence in the world in this man, Jeff Jarrett, that, like I said, I've been against him in the ring. And I've been partners with him. I've never had a greater tag partner in all my life.
Well, I think maybe what has happened, I think the Brawlers may have gone back just a few weeks, and you haven't had that many single matches lately. And maybe they figure, hey, they can't wrestle single, but I don't think they know the history. Jeff was talking about it, and as you have just said, boy, you guys single, you were great single wrestlers before you ever teamed up with anybody as a tag team.
Well, Dave, you know, when you look back in a guy's history, I mean, you go back to the very first match he had, you put all of these matches together, naturally you're not going to have wins every night. That I think that's what they've done, and they've got the wrong idea where Jeff and I are concerned. That I just, Winston-Salem 1 year ago beat Ricky Steamboat for the North American Heavyweight Championship, defended that thing against some of the top stars throughout all of the country, campaigned it all around, and only gave that up recently to come in and be partners with Jeff. We wound up winning these belts, and I stuck it out with him, and it wound up being really the greatest break I've ever had in all of my life.
Well, I tell you, it's been one of the greatest tag teams for us to watch in a lot of years, and it's terrific you guys have got the belts back. One thing worries me a little bit, though, being in a single match, it's going to be a situation where you don't have your partner. You don't have the ability to get over there and make a tag, no matter who you're going against. And even though you are great single wrestlers, is it going to take you some time to get acclimated to the fact that Jeff's not going to be in the corner?
I don't think so, Dave. Just as you see Jeff in here right now, he's moving around real nice. He took this boy down. He's all over top of him. Hey, you know, I wrestle the same way, that we go out there, whether it's single or whether it's tag, and try to get our singular job done. And that's what we expect to do. Now, these boys are going to come out there, I can tell you right now. I'm glad it's no disqualification, and I'm glad there's no time limit, that there's no way out of this except to run these guys out of town or them run us out. I like it that way. Let them bring their chairs. Let them load themselves down. I meant what I said, boy. They want to fight. They got the right two guys here to fight. We're both looking forward to going out in the singles. I'm going to be watching Jeff's back. He's not going to be out there by himself. I'm going to be right there on the floor making sure that there's no interference from the outside.
Well, that's good to hear, because it's two separate matches. Now, usually in this situation, it's going to be a tag team match in which the losing team would have to leave the territory. This is two separate matches, a single match involving you and a single match involving Jeff.
Right, and as I said before, we're just one of us to lose. That would jeopardize our World's Tag Team Championships.
Exactly.
That, you know, we would certainly have to turn the belts over to the USWA offices if we were one of us beaten in this match. I'm going to say this. I got all the confidence in Jeff, and it's a time for him to really prove himself. This Sabu's tearing into him right here. That's about the only way he's going to get on Jeff. Jeff's certainly out-wrestling this entire match.
Yeah, Sabu coming in with that doubled-up right fist. Oh, look at that. Body slam on Jeff. Watch for Sabu to climb the ropes. There he goes. He's up on the top one. Ah, Jeff Jarrett moves out of the way.
He's, you know, he took a little bit too much time getting up there, and Jeff's pretty darn crafty. He's waiting for him to make his move, and he was right there at the right time.
Well, I think there's a good indication
move
that...
Move it, Jeff. Get up there, man.
There's Jeff on the
ropes.
Let's see. Sabu looks at the lights. Oh, my goodness. Jeff has
nice
the count of three.
Undefeated Jeff Jarrett, the way I see it.
Boy, he got a great win right there. Robert, thanks for the comments. I know you and Jeff want to celebrate that victory a little bit. And good luck on these single matches coming up against the Barroom Brawlers, numbers one and number two, with loser leave town stipulations there. The fans congratulate them as they head out of here. Jeff Jarrett, Robert Fuller, we'll be back here after this. The King has joined us once again.
Well, I'm back here. I just wanted to take a couple of seconds to say, you know, I didn't really get a chance to say a while ago, I saw you're fixing to do the run down the Memphis card again. I didn't get a chance to say how excited I am to be back at the Mid-South Coliseum. First of all, I want to say, you know, we want to thank the people of the Memphis Park Commission, because they were great over at the Pipkin Building, worked with the wrestling organization. Super, Bob Brame and Bill Wilson, all those people were great. But we are really looking forward to being back at the Coliseum, and I think the fans are excited about being back there too, you know.
I'm excited about being there. I'm going to be there Monday night. I can't wait to get back to the Mid-South Coliseum. It's one of those situations where, like I say, it was very good at the Pipkin Building. The folks were nice. We just needed more space. We were just bringing so many people in that we needed more space. The Coliseum is going to be set up for that. Also, there's a new security arrangement for the parking lot, so parking will be secure. The parking lot will be patrolled throughout the matches. So all in all, looks like a great situation for the fans coming up, and what a card, too.
It is going to be a great card. I'm excited about it. I want to mention just a couple of things real quick. They already put up the... You want to go ahead and go ahead with
all right, the card? Yeah, let's talk. You and I talk about the card, and then we'll talk about a couple of things you got coming up after that. All right, the opening match of the night, 8 o'clock is when it begins at the Mid-South Coliseum. Boy, it's good to say that. Brian Christopher going against Heartbreaker Randy Harris in the opening match. In the next one, the World Light Heavyweight title will be on the line. Superstar Bill Dundee against Nightmare Danny Davis. That's a bit unusual, but when a belt's on the line, you get any kind of pairing in there, right?
Well, exactly right. And these two guys had a match a couple of weeks ago that was just really outstanding, and Danny Davis just pushes Bill Dundee to the limit. It's a really good match, really is.
And then one coming up that I know you're not going to be too thrilled to hear about, Austin Kong going against Samson, and I did not know for sure earlier, and we said we'd get it checked out, and I do have confirmation. This is going to be a world heavyweight title match, so I know you'll be watching this one closely.
Well, I will be, because I just happened to see Samson in the back there, my first look at him, and this guy's a pretty big specimen himself, so I may have to be wrestling him instead of Austin Kong for the belt.
That's right, and then coming up, the first of two single matches, it's lose or leave town, no time limit, no disqualification. Robert Fuller will be going against brawler number two, and then in a match, separate match, Jeff Jarrett will be going against brawler number one. In each of those matches, it's lose or leave town, no time limit, no disqualification. The brawlers say they are just very confident. They weren't upset or anything. They say, hey, we checked the record. These guys can't wrestle as singles. We can beat them. They're going to be out of here. Well, as I said, they didn't go back far enough in the record books, I don't think. Jeff Jarrett and Robert Fuller will be looking to run the brawlers out of town one at a time. Could be a situation, of course, where, you know, Jeff could win or lose, Robert could win or lose. You could split up teams that way, too. That's the situation that comes up Monday night at the Coliseum. Back Alley Street Brawl will follow that. It continues until one team loses their clothes, a dirty white boy and a dirty white girl going against Dr. Tom Prichard and Miss Texas. First main event of the night, Hair versus the Mask King. Must be a winner in this one. It's going to be you going against Leatherface. You talked about it a little earlier, hair on the line. You don't like those matches. You've never lost your hair, but you want to unmask this Leatherface.
Oh, Dave, I beg to differ with you. I have lost my hair. Remember, if you remember, Austin Idol and Tommy Rich had the match with Austin Idol.
Oh, by golly, you're right.
Tommy Rich was under the ring, hid under the ring, and I wound up getting my head shaved. And believe me, that's why I said at that time, I swore I'd never be involved in another one of these, because it is absolutely the worst feeling that I, other than the time I broke my leg and was out for almost a year, that's the worst thing that's ever happened to me in the wrestling business. It is embarrassing, it's humiliating, and it takes forever before you feel like a human being again. And I don't want to go through that no matter what. So we're going to do our best to find out exactly what Leatherface looks like Monday night rather than getting my head shaved.
Well, that's right. You know, I had forgotten about that. I remember other things that happened in that match, but that's right. So that's the situation. Must be a winner in this one Monday night, and that's not all. The Southern Heavyweight title will be on the line. Hair versus Hair, must be a winner in this one. Cousin Harold against Eric Embry, the flamboyant one. Will have Tojo Yamamoto in the corner. 8 o'clock, Mid-South Coliseum, Monday night. Box office will be open at 10 o'clock, so you can pick up your tickets in advance. Don't miss this big action, Homecoming 91, returning to the Mid-South Coliseum. King, you've got a couple of things you want to talk about.
Yeah, just real quick, a couple of... next Saturday down in Greenville, Mississippi. We have a lot of great wrestling fans down in Mississippi. Greenville's kind of far away, but I'm going to be down there at Take Two Video Stores next Saturday afternoon in Greenville, Mississippi. See everybody down there. Also, next Sunday, of course, Lawler's Army goes out, and we do a lot of these benefit softball games. We got a big doubleheader coming up in Somerville, Tennessee, next Sunday afternoon at the North Campus Field at 1:30 up there to benefit the Phyllis Williams Fund, and everybody up in Somerville knows Phyllis Williams. And also, this afternoon, and just about an hour from now, I got a good friend of mine named Ben Rush, who has a couple of furniture stores here in Memphis, one on Park Avenue and one at 3400 Summer Avenue. He's closing the store on Summer Avenue. Everything's marked down, unbelievable low prices and everything. I'm going to be out there with everybody this afternoon at 1 o'clock from 1 until 3. It's at 3400 Summer Avenue, Summer and National, at Rush's Furniture Store. So come on by. I'm going to have free pictures for everybody. We'll be signing autographs, maybe a free ticket or two, I don't know, for Monday night. So come on by. That's this afternoon from 1 until 3 at Rush's Furniture Store at Summer and National.
Okay, great stuff. Thank
you. You're gonna be there. I want you to bring the cameras, because we're gonna let everybody see what Leatherface looks like.
I'll be there Monday night, 8 o'clock at the Mid-South Coliseum. Don't forget, the box office will be open at 10 o'clock for advance ticket sales. Well, now coming into the area right here, Tony Anthony, the dirty white boy, and Kim, dirty white girl, headed this way. Let's see if we can talk to him just for a couple of minutes here before we get into more action. Tony, I want to talk about the situation coming up with this tag team match.
Yeah, you know, Miss Texas, she's tried everywhere in the world to embarrass and humiliate the dirty white girl. And once again, she comes up with some type of match, her and Dr. Tom Prichard, to where when you lose, you get stripped. Well, Miss Texas, to be perfectly honest, I don't see it happening to the dirty white girl or myself. By the time we get through, you're going to be standing there. She's going to look like a jaybird, and we're going to show everybody what them little old spare legs look like. What do you think?
Not only is she going to be standing there with no clothes on, she's going to be standing there without any hair, too, because I'm going to snatch it all out.
And you know, now we get to Dr. Tom Prichard. You know, Tom, you come out here and you always talking about how great a professional wrestler you are. Well, I give a devil his due, because he is a good, great professional wrestler. But you see, Prichard, this is not a wrestling match. This is a back alley street brawl. So, son, you get your blue jeans, your cowboy boots, whatever you want to wear, because, brother, this is my type of match. After I get through sticking this fist down your throat, I'm going to strip you like you would a baby, and me and the white girl are definitely going to walk out the winners.
Tony Anthony, the dirty white boy. Okay, thank you, Tony. And Kim, dirty white girl, they've got a back alley brawl match coming up. They head out right now. In the ring, the Scorpion is already there. His opponent will be coming this way very shortly. I promised you earlier that we would be introducing you to Samson. Here he comes, headed up to the ring area right now. And I see him coming around, yeah, this way, and steps up on the apron. He is a tall, he's a big one, let me tell you. Referee Paul Neighbors, watching the situation, calls for the bell to sound, and we are underway. Samson against the Scorpion. Boy, the Scorpion, I don't know, he may have a weight advantage on Samson, but he sure doesn't have a height advantage. Samson, he doesn't have a strength advantage either. Did you see that? Samson just pushed him back into the ring, knocked him right down on the mat. Scorpion, Scorpion says he had to pull my mask. He can't be that strong. I think he is. Samson with that wrist. He just shoves the Scorpion back down to the mat again. Keep in mind, now, this Scorpion, he doesn't weigh 150 pounds. He weighs up in the neighborhood of probably 260, 280. He's a big one. And Samson having no trouble moving him around the ring. Look at this. Picks him straight up in the air. A body slam. And a Scorpion holding his back as he gets back on his feet. He's not used to anybody being big enough to slam him like that. Samson with a clothesline, and the Scorpion again hits the mat. That's where he's been a good part of the day so far, on the mat. Samson with a forearm has the Scorpion back on the ropes, whips him across the way, catches him with the upper arm coming off of there, and the Scorpion, perplexed, can't figure out what's happening here. Samson, again, sends him into the ropes. Oh, my goodness, he grabs him. Hey, he had to give it up. Samson, able to get a submission hold as he grabbed the Scorpion coming off those ropes. And a Scorpion, as he put the squeeze on, the Scorpion immediately yelled, yeah, I give it up, I give it up. And Samson, accepting the congratulations of the crowd, as he heads out of here, this is all we need to see right here. Reggie, be fine. Reggie is carrying the world title, got the fur coat, got all the gold back on. Reggie, be fine. Reggie, you've got that belt now, but I wouldn't get used to having it.
Hey, it sounds like conspiracy, man. Hey, hold this up a little further. You see what I did with the $10,000 bonus money, didn't you, baby? I know you low budgets like this, don't you? I know y'all like this.
You spent all the money and didn't give your wrestler any of it, it looks like.
Hey, you let me worry about that, brother. You let me worry about that. Only thing I got to say, hey, it's going to be a long time before the king see this again, baby. You know what I mean? It's going to go right up on my shelf with all the rest of the gold I got. You see, I still got all my gold.
I see that. I see it.
Awesome Kong beat Lawler like a dog, man. But you know what? I'm going to give the devil his due. Lawler put up a good fight. My man, he was bruised up a little bit. You know, he cheated, hit them all in the face, and jumping them when his back was turning, all of those stuff. But I will give the devil his due. Lawler is a nice wrestler. You know what I mean? He's a good top 10 wrestler. But he'll never get another shot at this, baby. Never.
You're not going to give him a return?
He will not never get a return. Now, we got some punk. I just seen him up in the ring. What's his name? Sampson?
Sampson.
Yeah, Sampson. Now, he's pretty. He looks nice. He got a nice bite on him. But you know what? I remember a little fairy tale about 20,000 years ago or something. I don't know. I don't remember. But you remember that old fairy tale with Sampson and Dolores, right?
Sampson and Delilah, I think it was.
Well, Denise, Delilah, whoever she was, the bimbo. You seen what the bimbo did to the boy, right? But when he get in the ring with Awesome Kong, it gonna be the same flavor, baby. Because Awesome Kong gonna grab that boy in the back of his head and snatch every hair out of it. He gonna go down like a punk. One, two, three. We gonna beat him. And we gonna beat each and every one of our opponents we get in this ring with. And there's one more thing I wanna say while I'm thinking about it, man. Last week, before that match started, man, that no good punk Jerry Lawler took one of my gold watches, man.
Oh, come on.
Wait a minute, man. Hey, he took one of my gold watches and threw it to some low-budget redneck buckwheat was sitting out in the crowd. He just don't know. I called my lawyer. Come Monday morning, Jerry Lawler, somebody going to be knocking on your door, boy, and they're going to be the sheriff department. It's in you or someone to get my gold Rolex back, man.
Well, we'll see about that. And I tell you another thing we'll see about. As I said, don't get used to hanging onto this belt. Not only is the king looking for it, as the king pointed out, he may be having to wrestle Samson for it, because from what we've seen here today, Samson can take care of himself in the wrestling ring. So show up, bring the belt this week, all right?
We're gonna get beat like a dog, man.
Well, you'll have to be done in the ring, so bring Awesome Kong and we'll see. Back here in just a moment. I'll take just a few seconds here to bring you up to date on the situation. Championship Wrestling has been had to change times many times due to NBA basketball, due to tennis. Notre Dame football is coming up this fall on NBC and TV5, and for that reason, USWA Wrestling beginning next week, our new regular time, every Saturday thereafter, unless there's something special, USWA Wrestling will begin at 10 a.m. beginning next Saturday. So be sure to be watching beginning at 10 o'clock next Saturday morning. Right here, Dr. Tom Prichard and Ms. Texas. You've got the Texas belt in hand, I see.
You know something else that gets me? As I look around the USWA, I see people like Eddie Marlin. I see people like Jerry Lawler who get their way every time they turn around. But you see, Monday night, for all these people who think that the dirty white girl is so fine looking, and they have fantasies in their mind about her and wonder what she'd look like with nothing on at all. For all you people that think she's so hot, I got news for you. That little bird leg, spindly leg, big nose, hog face little girl is going to be completely stripped down Monday night at the Coliseum, where all you perverts can get your looks and can get your jollies. Because I'll tell you this, Monday night, the losing team is going to be the man, is going to be the woman that's going to be stripped completely. And I can tell you this, in the Coliseum, what a better way to do it, Miss Texas. What a better way to show everybody exactly what that ugly, bird leg, disgusting little girl looks like when you tear off her entire clothes. What do you think?
Well, let me tell you something. Dirty white girl, Monday night, the loser get their clothes ripped off. I'm going to show you a little bony tail something that you don't mess with, Miss Texas. Because the only thing big on your body is that big nose.
That's right. And we're going to show everybody, if you want to see what this dirty white girl looks like with all her clothes torn off, for all you guys, bring your cameras, because this is going to be your chance. Me and Miss Texas are doing it all.
Dr. Tom Prichard and Miss Texas back here with tag team action, the superstar, the nightmare, in just a moment. Hey, Davis, got a match, partners with Bill Dundee here today, but I wanted to give you a chance to say a word or two before you get into the action.
You know, Dave, it's always a pleasure to come out here and talk to you and all the fine fans. And before Bill and I get into our tag match, I'd like to talk about this week's upcoming title defense, because, you know, for the past several months, this belt has meant a lot to me. It's meant a lot to the fans, because I've been a people's champion. Every time I step into the ring, I always try to do the right thing. I always tell the little nightmare fans, say no to drugs, don't smoke, don't drink. Always do what your parents ask you and do the right thing. So, you know, as a champion, you have to accept your challenges from near and far. Now, if a champion could pick his own opponent, that would be easy. I would have nothing but easy wrestling matches. But, you know, that's just not the way it is. The promotion has seen fit to book my good friend, my traveling companion, superstar Bill Dundee, in a match against me for this title. And one thing I like about this is it's going to be a scientific match. It's going to be a wrestling match. If the fans come to see a fight, well, you're not going to see a fight, because Bill and I are friends. We've been friends for a number of years. And I know that when I step into that ring, I'm not going to have to worry about Bill using a fist on me. I'm not going to worry about Bill having to pull my hair, you know, like you do with other opponents. That's one thing I respect about Bill Dundee, is that he, in his own right, he is a fantastic man, a good...
Danny.
And a good friend.
Hey, brother. What? Let's not sugarcoat this thing no more, man.
What?
Yeah, come on. I don't know if you're trying to zoom me or the people here. We're talking about a belt, the light heavyweight championship of the world.
Yeah.
And you got it. And yeah. I'd like to have it. So, brother... Dan, come on.
Bill, no. I know you want this belt, and I know that all the years that you've wrestled in this area, you've held every major championship that this promotion has to offer except one. The one that you have not held is this title. Now, the promotion saw fit to put us in a match together, but we're friends.
Yeah?
We are friends.
Well, let me ask you this. This may take a day or two to sink after this week. I hope we are friends 3 or 4 days after this match takes place. Just think about that for a little while. Just listen to me, Dan. Short of throwing fire at you, short of bringing powder into the ring,
what?
Or hitting you with a chain, I'm not going to do none of them things, and I don't think you are either.
No.
But, brother, you're going to do everything in your power to hang on to this, and I'm going to do everything in my power to take it.
Did you have to do that?
We're pals, Danny!
Yeah, that's right. We are pals, but you don't have to do that. Yeah, and you're right. I'm not going to throw fire at you. I'm not going to pull your hair. I'm not going to pull a chain out. I'm going to go out there, and I'm going to wrestle you just like friends would wrestle. I'm not going to go out, and I'm not going to take advantage of anything.
Yeah,
that's
well,
just the way I am.
No. You're not zooming me down. We are pals, and like I said, 3 or 4 days after this is all over and it's sunk in what's happened in the end of it, see, we're still
friends. So what you're saying is you're going to do everything possible to take this belt away from me.
Oh, yeah, and you're going to do everything you know to keep it. Come on, brother.
Hey,
you didn't get it at no Sunday school picnic.
No, I didn't get it no Sunday school picnic, but the only reason I wear this belt is because these good people out here put their faith and support in me, and I've always been a people's champion.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you something.
Well,
since you want to come out here and to tell the truth, you want to tell the truth? Well, maybe you're right. Maybe I will do everything in my power to keep this title, because this title means a lot to me, and it means a lot to these fans. So I'll tell you what. Since you want to tell the truth, Bill Dundee, you get on my nerves a little bit. You know why? No, you know why? Because for the past several months, you and me have been traveling up down the highways, and every time we step into a local restaurant, here comes Bill Dundee. Hey, 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 y'all, Bill Dundee's here. Well, I'm not quite as boisterous as you. I don't like to go into a restaurant and make a butt out of myself. And there's another thing. There is another thing that you do that I don't like. Every time that you step in the ring with any opponent, it doesn't matter if the opponent is experienced. It doesn't matter if you've got a green wrestler up there that you take advantage of. Every time that wrestler trips and falls down, you know what you do? You stand up in the ring and go, woo! Well, to me, that embarrasses me, because I am a wrestler. I'm not up there to show my tail.
Well, I'll tell you something, brother. I'll tell you what bothers you when we go to a restaurant. You haven't got that stupid star painted on your face, and everybody says, hey, Bill Dundee, who's your buddy? And I got to tell him it's Danny Davis, and he's another thing.
You don't have to
wait till this week, brother. Let's just bring this belt, this thing, and haul it up in here. We wrestle right now.
Hey, you're exactly right. We don't have to wait till this week. We can do it right
now.
Hey, come on. You guys are partners here today, for heaven's sakes. Danny Davis and Bill Dundee going after each other. Out here talking about the match they've got coming up in which they're against each other for belt. Eddie, let's... USWA is going to sanction the match here. It's Danny Davis, the Nightmare, against Bill Dundee. 2 minutes ago, these guys were going to be partners going against another tag team up here in tag team action today. Now, all of a sudden, here's referee Paul Neighbors. That makes it official. Let me ring the bell again just to make it official. And the match is underway. The superstar Bill Dundee against the man who was his partner up until 2 minutes, 3 minutes ago, Danny Davis. Dundee with Danny down on the mat. He's got the left arm pulled up behind his back. Couple of rugged competitors here. I think that's the problem. I think they're both so competitive, and I think Dundee, I think he pointed out correctly that, you know, you're going to do everything you can to win. I'm going to do everything I can to win, short of breaking the rules. I tell you what, makes for some kind of match. We've got it for you right here. Danny Davis, the Nightmare, the superstar, Bill Dundee. Davis with Dundee in the head scissors right now. He's got those feet wrapped around his neck. Danny Davis with the advantage at the moment. Dundee trying to figure a way out of it. He is out of it. The way he did, he just finally was able to work around and slip out of the hole. That's tough on your ears when you do that, but Bill did it and now ends up with the advantage, where a moment ago it was Davis that had the advantage. Now advantage Dundee. Danny Davis trying to figure a way out of this. As he bridges up to try to get out, Dundee is able to put that elbow right in his back and force him back down to the mat. Davis kicks him back to the rope. Puts the flip on him with the boots coming off of there. Dundee quickly on his feet and backs to a corner. Danny Davis, Bill Dundee. Pound for pound, maybe the two toughest competitors in professional wrestling. Davis trying to turn him around into a Boston Crab. Not able to do it yet. Well, he's got it right now. Can he make it stick? Referee is right there. No, Dundee is able to reverse him. My goodness, that's not easy to do, but he did it. These two guys, first one with the advantage and then the other. Look at that. Oh, my goodness. You talk about a couple of veterans going after each other. Neither of them wants to get pinned. Both of them determined that they are going to be the winners of this match. This match was not even scheduled today. Got into a disagreement. They're in there. The promotion says, book it. Let them go. Put a referee in there. That's where we are right now. Neither wrestler so far able to gain a clear advantage for very long. Look at that. Reversal by Danny Davis. Oh, he caught it with a right hand there. Yeah, I think Danny may have slipped there and popped him with a right fist. He said it was going to be fair and square. Maybe that's gone by the wayside. Look at this. Davis presses him, jumps out of the ring down here on the floor. Referee Paul Neighbors out. He's tolling the count. Both of them down here battling on the floor. There's a forearm from Danny Davis, a boot from Bill Dundee, and Dundee answers with that right hand. Oh, my goodness. Danny Davis run into the ring post. The two of them battling out here on the floor. Davis against Dundee. Now they're back on the ring apron. Danny Davis, Bill Dundee back into the ring as these two continue to go at each other. Davis with a right fist again. Knocks Dundee off his feet. There's a cover. One, two, oh, only got a two count. Did not get the count of three. Dundee trips him up. Spins on a toe hold. Sits down on it. Danny Davis yelling. Is he going to give it up? No, he doesn't. He pounded Dundee. Got him right above the eyes. Time, I tell you what, we are at a time bind here. We've got some commercials we're going to have to get in. If we could, let's keep the videotape rolling. We'll take this commercial break, and we'll let you know what happens when we return. Well, nothing happened while we were away as far as action goes. Dundee left. He was upset. Davis has just left, too. This one's not settled. It's going to continue, let me tell you that. We'll continue, too, next week. Michael St. John will be back with us then. Until next week, Dave Brown. So long, everybody.
The announcers on this program are selected and paid by parties other than this station, namely the promoters of USWA Championship Wrestling.